high DHT? Is high DHT from scrotal testosterone cream dangerous? This video is all about the discussion between two TRT experts, Dr. Jim Meehan and Dr. Keith Nichols.
Please like and subscribe. Thank you.
Let's start with the TOT Doctors Roundtable video in which Dr. Jim Meehan said this.
Should I stick with the scrotal cream and take some DHT lowering substances?
I'm going to jump all over this question because I love that somebody asked this question. There's been a lot of activity on the message boards talking about the transcrotal testosterone cream. And I use a version of it in my protocol, but I've just been sitting back quietly, you know, not wanting to chime in because I'm kind of at odds with some of my colleagues in this area. For me, this is the same song, second verse. About 8 or 9 years ago, this transcrotal cream was kind of a fad and you know, some of the markets that I was involved in. And we were testing it, you know, prolifically. I'm a data scientist. I like really collecting a lot of data on these things. So one of the things that you get with, I mean, if you're putting any place close to 200 milligrams or 100 milligrams of testosterone on your scrotum, you're going to have massive DHT levels. And you're going to feel, now, what guys like is they love the feel of high DHT. It's a very powerful androgen. You want to have your androgen optimized. You'll get amazing results. But you can get, last week I had a patient that is, my protocol put you, it's 25 milligrams of testosterone on the scrotum to try to optimize that DHT level. You will find even at 25 milligrams that guys will respond with a DHT in the 2000s. Can you imagine what happens when you put 100 milligrams or 200 milligrams on the scrotum? I don't have to imagine. I've seen the levels. It's in, you know, the 10,000s. And so you feel amazing for a very short period of time. But what I believe, this is my own theory, having worked with these situations, is that you create some receptor dependence and resistance, and you will start creating some receptor downregulation. There is almost no system in the body that doesn't obey these kind of laws of homeostasis. If you are oversaturating, overstimulating a receptor system, whether it be opioids, antidepressants, or dihydrotestosterone, you can create some resistance. Homeostasis will push against that. You'll downregulate androgen receptors, and then you'll, you know, what felt amazing, Superman, bulletproof, you know, awesome, can actually then lead to a very significant decline later on. And so, you know, I encourage, and I've kind of been doing this mildly on the message boards, is go experiment all you want, but make sure you're measuring those DHT levels, and you know, because you don't want to blow out your hair, inflame your prostate perhaps, or exacerbate an underlying, you know, psychiatric disorder, because that's one of the things that you can also get from really high levels of DHT is you can get some psychiatric behavior that is not conducive to normal relationships. So I'm a little bit concerned about this hype of, you know, transcrotal testosterone only at the levels that we're talking about. And then more to the point is, it's fine if you measure it. It might work for you. Some people it does. And you might manifest with, you know, reasonable levels that are safe and effective. But if you don't measure it, and the other side of this hype has been, you don't have to worry about measuring it. It's awesome. You're going to feel great. Well, this is an area that I think that you need to measure. Follow your, you know, check your DHT. And unfortunately, dihydrotestosterone in the lab test is one of the more expensive lab tests. It's you know, you're looking at about $120-$130 to test your DHT. So a lot of guys skip that, and they never see that their, you know, that their DHT levels are really, you know, they're in the stratosphere. And I just don't think that's healthy. So I think transcrotal testosterone has its place. I use it in my Man Up protocol. It's a combination of injections and a small amount of cream. And then, you know, my cream includes pregnenolone, DHEA, and vitamin D, as well as the testosterone. So you create the baseline with the injections, and then you create a rhythm with the transcrotal cream. I in mine, you put 25 milligrams on the scrotum and 25 milligrams on the upper inner thigh. And then depending on what their follow-up labs look like, if they are really a hyper responder, like the gentleman that was in the 2000s, then we'll move it, you know, to all upper inner thigh or as far away from the testicles as we can, because some guys just have a massive 5-alpha reductase system. And this was a pretty young guy that happened. And we know that 5-alpha reductase increases in older men. So you also have to be careful if you're a little bit older, because your transcrotal response might be result in a much higher DHT levels. I think DHT is one of those important measures that you want to have in the optimal zone, but not in the super, you know, stratospheric, super physiologic level, because it's just not going to be good for you in the long term.
No need to say, this got a lot of men worried. And since I myself do use transcrotal testosterone cream twice daily, and I made several videos with the help of Dr. Keith Nichols stating how many advantages this way of delivering TRT has, I started doubting myself. Then, a lot of commenting back and forward between Keith Nichols and Jim Meehan started under the video, as well as in our closed Facebook group. And I am getting personal messages about this issue as I am making this video. To help you all out and to make things pretty clear, I will now summarize the comments of Keith Nichols and the replies of Jim Meehan. Not everything said or written was very polite, but still, I was able to stay neutral and, as a medical professional myself, distill both their views on this issue to present them right here for you. Keith started with this comment, which I pinned on top. Be careful to always consider opinion versus science. The pharmacokinetics of testosterone applied transcrotally are described as well as what occurs with estradiol and DHT. DHT has not been shown to cause prostate cancer or hypertrophy. It is over the counter in some countries because it hasn't been shown to cause harm. The concern of prostate cancer, etc., with the transcrotal application is nonsense. Do you think because you are applying it there, which is closer to the prostate than the inner thigh, that it is going to just go to the prostate? That is not science. The scrotum is simply the best area for absorption. The skin is thin and there is good vasculature. Once again, look at the literature. It is absorbed into the bloodstream, not the prostate. The prostate has its own control mechanisms for intraprostate DHT levels. You can have high serum DHT levels and the intraprostatic DHT levels are not affected. Once again, that is in the medical literature. This fear-mongering to support a protocol that uses injections and creams based on opinion, not science. Marketing to the vulnerable. Hippocrates said it best. There are in effect two things, science and opinion. The former begets knowledge and the latter ignorance. Jim Meehan replied, I admit to measuring and monitoring important hormones like DHT and estradiol. Thus, I can legitimately claim to optimize hormones. Based on what Keith told me about his care and lab monitoring, he simply can't claim to simply optimize hormones when he simply don't measure any hormone but testosterone. That's not how it all works. On which Keith wrote at Jim, then you are saying Dr. Rousier knows nothing. He is a close friend and mentor and I follow his teaching exactly as he instructs. I questioned him along the way, always looking for something to disprove what he was saying. I couldn't do it. But Jim, in all your infinite wisdom, why don't you prove what he says is wrong? He has forgotten more than you will ever learn. With you testing for levels on things that you won't change shows me you are still in your infancy with regard to hormone optimization. You don't know what you don't know. But let's say this for fact. In over 70 years of raising men's DHT and estradiol by giving testosterone, there has been no harm. It doesn't cause prostate cancer, and in fact, some men are choosing to continue their testosterone with active prostate cancer, and you are not blocking DHT. In no study showing the positive effects of testosterone did we block DHT or estrogen. If you don't want a better libido and energy, then block DHT. I wrote, Keith, the day when you're ready for it, please consider confronting Jim Meehan on a podcast on my channel about the compounded cream and DHT issue. I'd like to hear the scientific fact behind both your statements, opinions. Keith answered, I will gladly do it. When Jim or anyone else uses the word might or could, etc., it means they don't have the evidence to say it does. As I told Jim tonight, we have been raising men's DHT and estradiol with testosterone for over 70 years without causing harm. In none of the studies showing the benefits of testosterone did they block DHT. In fact, men with active prostate cancer are choosing to continue their care, and in those men with active prostate cancer, they are not blocking DHT. Giving men 50 mg via transcrotal application does not raise DHT to 2000, nor does it raise testosterone to 2000. Journal of Andrology 2017. Now you can't make DHT without testosterone. When you give testosterone via the transcrotal application, the testosterone will peak in a couple of hours and then DHT after that, as testosterone is converted to DHT. You'd have to convert every bit of testosterone to DHT, which does not occur. It's just pure physiology. Jim will not be able to find a single study where raising DHT by giving testosterone caused prostate cancer or schizophrenia or downregulation of receptors, etc. The most brilliant man I know with regard to hormone replacement therapy is Dr. Neil Rousier. He gives hours and hours of literature on these topics. Does he block or measure DHT or estradiol in men? No, I don't either. Why would we measure something that we aren't going to block? Because it might cause harm if we don't. Not in any study to date in over 70 years. In our closed Facebook group, which I really like to invite you to join, the following things were written. Jim Meehan. Steven, that's me. Please see if you can get Keith to show up and debate me on the science of male hormone therapy. I think we need a far more reasonable discussion than what I saw in Dr. Nichols' post. In the meantime, I will share and support my arguments, science and protocols on my business page and share them here. I hope Dr. Nichols can do the same. I recommend that anyone that is experimenting with the high-dose transcrotal testosterone approach measure your DHT levels and report them here. Many of you will be very surprised by what you find. I am informed by Dr. Nichols that he does not test DHT. Therefore, if you need help ordering a low-cost DHT lab through LabCorp, contact my office at support@catalystmd.com and I can get you a requisition and a very low price test. Keith replied, please, Jim, produce the study. If you don't want a better libido and sexual function, then block it. The recent podcast, Jim uses the word might and could, etc. Those are words we use when we don't have the evidence to say it does. DHT is over the counter in some countries. There is no massive outbreak of schizophrenia or prostate cancer. The studies show the intraprostate DHT levels are controlled even with high serum levels. So in over 70 years it hasn't been a problem, but now all of a sudden it is. So I will quote Dr. Rousier when someone says something might do this, or that despite no study showing it to be true. There might be men on Mars, but there's not. Jim wrote, Keith, please educate us on what science you use to determine the safety of 150 to 200 mg of testosterone applied to the scrotum. Also, how do you assess safety when you admit to not measuring biomarkers like DHT? Do you have some evidence to support your belief that there is no level of DHT that is potentially unsafe? I believe you said, men could literally swim in DHT, it's so safe. Perhaps DHT is unique in that high levels don't eventually result in homeostatic compensation and receptor downregulation. If so, to my knowledge, it is not only the only sex hormone not to do so, but perhaps the only receptor ligand of any kind to not do so. As far as dosing goes, the pharmacokinetic study performed on transscrotal testosterone only went up to 50 mg. My protocol recognizes this literature and delivers 25 to 50 mg to the scrotum, typically 25 mg to the scrotum and 25 mg to the upper inner thigh. There's my science. Now show me yours. I often see 25 to 50 mg of testosterone on the scrotum result in DHT levels in the thousands. I see it because I actually measure it. Because I measure it, I can adjust it to ranges that I consider optimal, 400 to 700 in a 50 to 500 reference range. Case in point, a recent new patient in his 40s responded to 25 mg on the scrotum and 25 mg to the upper inner thigh with a DHT level in the 1900s, reference range 40 to 500, and yet his T levels were not proportionally as high as the DHT. These markedly elevated DHT levels with symptoms of new onset anxiety, irritability and insomnia. Not to mention itchy flaky scalp. I'll attach a picture of these labs as soon as I get a chance. Also, I don't agree with your assumptions that DHT will be proportional to the T level. That was not the case in the case I just described. Transscrotal testosterone predictably increases DHT levels in a manner that is not always proportional. That's why I include it in my protocols, to raise DHT to optimal levels, not simply because of the more rapid absorption. If you measure these things, you would see the same results I've seen and you might have the same concerns. Personally, I think doctors that don't measure the results of therapy are not only doing their patients a disservice, but they fail to recognize the biological diversity and individual uniqueness that can often produce unpredictable results. If you don't measure and monitor, you don't recognize when your therapy might not be working the way you and the patient expect. Furthermore, not properly monitoring hormone replacement therapy is a good way to lose your medical license and leave your patients without a doctor. You are very unlikely to survive a medical board review in the unfortunate event that the patient is harmed and you neglected to monitor the biomarkers associated with your therapy. I look forward to your evidence on the safety of high-dose testosterone applied to the scrotum. I am also eager to confirm a date and time for our debate on these matters. So, to conclude, I hope these comments made things more clear for you, where both gentlemen stand with their opinions, and I hope you are able to make out for yourself what you can conclude from all this. I sincerely hope both are willing to have an online live debate on this very topic during one of the next TOT Doctors roundtables.